Welcome to NIOS. Myself, Dr. Yukti Sharma from Department of Education, University of Delhi. Today, I am going to discuss with you developing learning materials to foster creativity. This is a link of a video that you can see on the website www.arvindguptatoys.com. Now, this video shows how through storytelling we can show the various uses of a newspaper and how newspaper through origami could be folded and made into different kinds of caps and hats, and then finally it shows that it is converted, the same newspaper is converted into a life jacket. Now, why I am referring to this video is because it shows that how a newspaper, which after we read it is for us it's of no use, could be through origami be used in various ways, right? And also it could be used for storytelling to the children. Now, this kind of a video could be an important resource for making children, stimulating children think about that how materials around us could be used in various ways. Now, when they start thinking this, obviously they engage in thinking about the same material in different ways. So, this video could help in triggering the original thinking in them, thinking about the usefulness of newspaper, that is the resourcefulness of newspaper, thinking about how my thinking could be divergent, what all I can think, how many various ways I can think. So, therefore, I conclude by saying that learning material could be in any form. It could be a video also for us when we are talking about developing learning materials for fostering creativity. It could be a video, it could be an audio, it could be a story, it could be any kind of activity, it could be any kind of a model. So, we have to think about these materials open-mindedly, that it can be in any form. This is the first thing. The second is that it should engage the learners and stimulate them to think creativity. So, how is my material, whether I am showing a video or I have made a puzzle for the children, how is it engaging the learners? Whether it makes them think creatively. Creatively means originally, divergently. So, that is the second important thing. The third is, it can be a story, puzzle, activity, as I said, video or an audio clip. It could be a model, specimen, a kit, anything that we can think of which is engaging them to think creatively. Now, before going on to the development of materials, we should first try to understand, which you would have discussed in earlier sessions also, what are the perspectives of creativity. Now, there are two major perspectives of creativity. The first is the small c creativity. Small c creativity means everyday creativity in our day-to-day life, whatever we do, and it sometimes gives us personal happiness also. I did this thing in a very different way. I do the tree in a very different way. Sometimes children come and say, you see how differently I have drawn the tree. The other children have not drawn in the similar way. So, it could be any personal, everyday, day-to-day original work that we have done. The second thing is small c creativity talks about is that it is developmental, that it is definitely some potentiality is innately present, everybody is innately potential, but that innate potentiality could be developed also. And the third thing, of course, is that everyone has the potentiality. On the other hand, the big C creativity talks about the eminent and the genius people who have contributed to the society in a similar way. Now, in small c perspective, the contribution at a larger level is not important, but big C creativity looks at what contribution the person has made at a larger level, at the level of the society. And that is why most of the literature in big C creativity is looking at the personalities retrospectively, means after they have contributed. So, through autobiographies and biographies, it's tracing back how their life had been. And therefore, these are those people who have already accomplished And this literature looks at only few people who could reach at that level of accomplishment. Now, both the perspectives of creativity are equally important, because both of them help us to understand that what experiences are there which have inspired these people to work originally, to work in their own ways, to contribute the society fruitfully. Now, if Big C tells us about all this, on the other hand, small c helps us that what little things we can do in a class, in a school, in our day-to-day life, that will help children to nurture that potentiality in them. Some of the abilities which have been identified within these two perspectives are, one is fluency. Now, when we are talking of creativity, of course, we have to come down to the level of what creative thinking is. Because it is, this is one of the ways in which creativity gets manifested. How do we think? So, if our thinking has fluency, fluency is the large number of responses that we are able to generate. Like, for example, just now we were talking about newspapers. Now, the number of ways a child can think of the child can use the newspaper in. So, those number of ways the child is able to think is the fluency. Flexibility means the different ways in which the child can think. Ways means in different context. So, flexibility is whether the child can think that reading the newspaper is one context, but making a boat out of that newspaper on a rainy day to float it in a puddle of water, that is changing the context. So, that is the flexibility. So, how many different contexts that we think in which we can use the newspaper, like covering the windows with the newspaper in order to get shade. So, there could be many such contexts. This is called flexibility in thinking. The third is originality. What is different that we are thinking? If we are thinking about, suppose, newspaper only and its use, how our thinking is different? What are the conventional ways of thinking, and how my thinking is unconventional, different from the others' thinking? Inquisitiveness is the ability to raise a number of questions out of curiosity. Then persistency is how we are able to commit to a particular way of thinking or a task, and we are able to persistently pursue it. The last is elaboration, the ability to add details to the given situation or problem at hand. So, that means understanding the situation or the given problem in many ways, not understanding it in one way, and therefore going into the minute details of the given situation. Apart from this, some other abilities which are associated with creativity are, one is risk taking. Now, risk taking doesn't mean that we are talking about only physical risk. Here, risk taking means it could be psychological also. It could be social also. For example, because you are thinking in a particular way, people may not like you, right? So, that kind of a risk is involved in creativity. Because you are thinking unconventionally, definitely you are thinking in a way which is not the thinking of most of the people. And therefore, you may be socially at risk also. You may be isolated also. So, but these people are, both the literature from Big C creativity as well as small c says that whether it's an adult or it's a child, they take risk in their own ways. In a child, even in fact, a child in the class also is at risk when the child is giving a different answer, because children start excluding the child from their group, that, oh, he says some weird things which we don't understand, which we don't believe in. So, that risk is always there, whether in a child's life or in an adult's life. Sensitivity is how you can see the details in your environment, what is happening around them. So, sensitivity simply doesn't mean sympathizing, but it means understanding cognitively your environment and the people who are there in your environment. Social boldness is the courage, which is again not a physical courage, but it's again a psychological, social courage, where you are able to go and talk to people who you believe are higher in authority, or who you believe are more powerful than you, because of certain societal norms and because of certain societal hierarchies. Passion. Passion is the love for a particular area or a particular topic or a particular kind of material, and you want to pursue with that particular task for a long time, not because that you are going to get something out of it, but just because you are in love with it. Of value or social worth, this is very important. Whatever we are pursuing, how it's going to value the society or the community around us. So this is also an important aspect of creativity. Now, after we have looked at some of the abilities and ideas which are associated with what creativity is, let's look at some of the principles for the development of learning materials to foster creativity in children. Now, the first principle is we need to show to the learners that their ideas have value. Now, as we were just discussing, there are certain social norms and certain hierarchies in our society because of which the ideas of adult are always considered more valuable than those of children. This is a hierarchy that we have established. But we need to understand that children's ideas are equally important. They are evolving. They are in their developing stages. They have their own logic. And until unless whatever material, whether we are showing a video or we are giving them something to read, if it is not conveying this message to them that their ideas are important, whether it is shown by projection, in a story if we show that a child is thinking and giving a solution, then the children start believing that they are also able to think original and what they are thinking also could be value to everybody around them, including the adults. So that hierarchy has to be questioned and somewhere importance has to be given to children's ideas. Then only they'll start thinking on their own. Second is the space for imaginative and unusual ideas. Our activities, our questions, the videos, audios should not end up or conclude by saying certain desirable ideas. They should be open-ended and they should invite and also convey that there is a possibility of some other idea also. These are not the only available ideas. This will help them to think other unusual ideas also, which we as teachers also might not have think. And sometimes when we give such spaces to children, they come up with different kinds of ideas which we have also not thought of. Relate to real life issues. Now, creativity is about social worth, is about community in which we are living in. It operates within the context of community and society, and therefore we have to relate whatever material we are making should be related to the real life issues. It involves challenging others' ideas, social or cultural norms, rules or practices. So whichever story we are showing or audio or video or a model that we are making, we should see that how these stories are questioning or challenging others' ideas or norms rather than reinforcing the existing ideas and norms. We should show them that they are challengeable. We can change them. Or every idea, every norm could be changed, questioned. Then we should present some exemplars of alternatives to the conventional ideas. We should ourselves present some alternative so that again they understand that there is always a possibility to think of alternatives. Each idea will have alternatives for itself and how we can think about it. Then presents passion and commitment as important values in all these materials. Coming to characteristics of the learning materials, what should be the characteristics? Again, the list is ever evolving, but still we should think about some of the characteristics. One is it should lead to a number of possible responses. Like just now we talked about, if I am asking in a classroom, what could be the uses of a newspaper? I am looking for any number of possible responses that are possible. And I am waiting for those responses. I am giving space to them. So therefore, it should not be a close-ended question that I am giving, but an open-ended which is inviting all possible responses. Third is that it should help the students in flexible thinking. So they should be triggered to think for different context. So if you were in this particular context, how would you do? So if you were in a village, what you would have done? If you are in a urban space or in an urban setting, what you would have done? Or if you would have in some other region, or you are in a coastal area, or you are a mountainous in a mountainous region, then how would you do it? So the context have to be multiple, so that people can shift their thinking from one context to another, and that shifting is important to develop flexible thinking. Should provide opportunities to think of new or original ideas, provide opportunities to think of alternatives, should encourage them to question the well established ideas. Also give them opportunity to imagine, look beyond what is visible. Now this is very important, because unless we don't believe in our capacities of mind and we only rely on what is visible to us, what is available to us, we won't be able to imagine. Imagination is something that goes beyond reality, and therefore it is important for the children to realize that they have to go beyond what is available to them. Must encourage them to challenge the conventional behaviors and not insist on a particular stereotype behavior. So these materials should again convey messages where they can show that how certain behaviors become conventional, why they become conventional, why certain behaviors are associated with girls only because they belong to a particular gender, and how they become stereotypes, and how we can challenge those stereotypes. So they should open-mindedly think about these stereotypes and how they can be questioned. Must have a context that has social relevance. So whatever they are thinking, they should be thinking in a particular context, and think also about that how their thinking is valuable. It could be for the class only, if they are in a school, in a particular classroom, how it can help, my thinking can help my classmates or the community in my school or the community into which I belong, which is outside the school. So the context is very important for whatever discussion or whatever material that we are creating. Some ideas that I have brought for developing learning materials include the puzzles, riddles, stories, mystery plots. Now these, we understand that they are very important part of a child's life and the child is always engaging in them, but we generally keep them outside our classroom experiences. Now whatever class again it is, whichever subject it is important that puzzles should be created and brought in a classroom. It can be a tool for assessment also, it can be used as a strategy for learning also. Similarly, riddles, because they help the child to think on their own, and in that solving process, they are thinking in many ways, and therefore it promotes their divergent thinking. Similarly, stories also can promote different kinds of thinkings, like thinking boldly or thinking in different ways or in problem solving. Similarly, mystery plots, looking for something which is not visible, so imagining something beyond which is visible. So all these should be important part of the classrooms, which will trigger divergent thinking in children. Similarly, models, kits which use locally available materials. For as an example of this, I have given a link for a video which is a model of a neuron, and this video shows that how the neuron, which is a scientific concept which is also called as a nerve cell, so how the structure of a nerve cell or a neuron can be made using locally available materials which are easily available to us. Now what material has to be used for that model, how it is available to us in our community, all that has to be thought about, and how it represents the material that we are representing, how we can explain that it represents what we are trying to show. Like in this case, for example, we are trying to show a neuron. So all that thinking again is somewhere encouraging creative thinking in the children. So they should be engaged in making these kinds of models. And again, we have to break that conventionality of using same kinds of materials for making models or kits. How they can think of some unconventional materials for representing the same concepts or making the same kind of models. Lot of activities have also been given in this regard on the website, which is www.eklavya.in. It has lots of books also in PDF forms, and also lots of activity books which would serve as a very good resource for developing creative thinking amongst children. Similarly, another important aspect is historical accounts of development of theories and ideas. Now, every theory and idea has not come de novo on its own. It has been the creation, it has emerged from the imaginative thinking of the scientist. So, if children are not engaged with how theories have come, how the ideas have evolved, how they have developed over a period of time, how human capacities, human thinking has contributed towards it, whether it is a scientist or whether it is a teacher or whether it is any other kind of researcher or scholar. So, how they or a thinker or a philosopher, how they have contributed to the knowledge basis or the knowledge resource. So, that has to be brought by tracing back the historical aspects of these theories and ideas. Similarly, autobiographies and biographies of social leaders, scientists, artists, poets who have contributed to the society is also very important. So, how they think, these biographies and autobiographies help the children to understand that how they think and how they translate their thinking into their actions. So, what all do they do in their life? So, not only it's an inspiration, but it also helps them to understand the various ways in which we can think or various ways in which we can act in our lives. Now, in this regard, there is another link which is about a video, which is again from arvindguptatoys.com website, and this video shows a method of addition. Now, it talks about a mathematician called Gauss, who in his childhood was given to add the first 10 numbers and first 100 numbers, and the video talks about that how all children started adding one number with the other number in a sequence. But he, instead of looking addition in the conventional way, he thought of looking at some patterns, and those patterns, how he discovered those patterns, and using that patterns he could emerge and he could evolve a formula for calculating the sum of a given sequence of numbers. Now, what I am trying to say is that again this video is a resource for us, it's a material for us that we can show for the children. It's a video of 1 minute and few seconds only, but it conveys that how our thinking could be different from others' thinking and how our thinking can help us to do the same work in a different way and more meaningful way. So, it saves our time also in addition, and also it gives us a different approach towards the same problem. Similarly, there are some activities and questions given on the website of Vigyan Prasar, which are also very helpful. Like this activity helps us to engage with divergent thinking. It talks about different leaves and different leaves. We know that leaves, there is a diversity in nature, and to understand that diversity, also we need to have a kind of thinking. There could be leaves of different shapes. So, if the leaves could be dried and pressed, then those leaves could be used to make different animals. Now, the activity engages children in thinking about which leaf could be used for making which animal. So, it depends upon the shape of the leaf and the shape of the animals, how they establish those correlations and create a zoo out of it. So, again, this kind of an activity could also be one way in which we can encourage divergent thinking. Then there is another activity which is also related to divergent thinking, in which they can predict also, think that how the seed grows, and for this different kinds of seeds are used. They can be told to predict which seed do you think will germinate first and which later, and they can observe and record. So, this could be another activity where they are engaged in thinking divergently and also engaged in predicting what is going to happen in a particular experiment. Now, this is an anecdote that I have taken from the website of NBT, and As we are talking about this, we can also think of anecdotes from our culture, because of all of us are operating in a particular culture, and there could be some stories that have a tinge of inspiration or creativity in them. Now, this story, this book is given on the NBT's websites, and it talks about the biography of a black US scientist, George Washington Carver, who was born at the fag end of American slavery era. And he became an orphan to struggle against hard times, but eventually worked his way up to become a renowned agronomist and an educationist with a progressive vision. What is remarkable is the manner in which he manages to stick to his commitment despite odds, his dedication to gain education, and his sincere behavior to uplift his black brethren and the larger humanity. So not only did he, the story of the biography of the scientist tells us that not only he evolved himself, but also how he helped the other people in his community to evolve and benefit from his evolution. So such kind of stories, autobiographies, could be used as a resource to encourage children, and which are coming from their own culture also, so that they can easily relate to it. Similarly, the storybooks from epics and great literature of the culture can be collected and stored. Other than this, there could be some activities which engage them in hypothetical situations. For example, thinking of what is not there again, thinking beyond the realities. If there was no sun on our planet, or if I was a bird, if I could go to moon. So making them write on these topics, making them think or present it in any way. If they don't want to write, they can also make a poster of it. They can make a presentation of it. So whichever way they want to present it, but engaging them in thinking about something hypothetical, so that they can dealing themselves from the realities and think beyond realities also. Similarly, this is an activity which helps in developing problem solving abilities. They all understand in science that how rain comes and how water vapor is formed and it gets converted into droplets. But can they make a model? So a problem is given to by the teacher where they have to make a model to demonstrate how rain takes place and the basic processes in rain formation. So how, whether they can do it or not. So this is one way in which they can present the phenomenon. In the end, I would like to conclude that creativity is something, and its development is something which requires we teachers also to be creative and thinking in original ways. We also need to think divergently, to look for different kinds of resources which are present in our own vicinities, in our own localities, in our own surroundings, and how we can use them for developing materials which can foster creativity in children. Some websites I have given in this regard. And I still hope that there are many more websites which you teachers can yourself also explore and use for creating such materials. So thank you, and see you in some other session.